The views and opinions expressed in this program are not necessarily those of Union Broadcasting Inc., ESPN 1510, or its employees. The host is solely responsible for the on-air content.
This is KC Cares, Kansas City's nonprofit digital resource. We're produced by Charitable Communications, and we'll tell the stories of Kansas City nonprofits and the people behind them. KC Cares is proudly sponsored by the Ewing Marion Kauffman Foundation. We have a terrific show today, and we have a little surprise. Santa is in the house, or in the studio, we should say. I hope you can hear that. Yes, yes, it's just around the corner. But you know what? Santa is here with a whole lot more to his story. Actually, our Santa today is John Scheuch, who is with Santa America. And we'll post pictures and video because John is not John in this studio. I think he's Santa John. Is who you look like, John.
I go by lots of different names.
As long as they're good and nice, right?
It's for everybody.
Tell us about Santa America, and we're based here in the heart of America. How cool is that?
It's great. We are part of the heartland. Santa America is a 501c3 that was founded in 2003 in Daphne, Alabama. And in 2016, we moved the headquarters operation to Overland Park. And I and my chief administrative elf, which happened to be my wife, operate Santa America. Our mission is to visit children in hospice care, children with chronic pediatric conditions, and children dealing with post-traumatic stress. And we train Santas all over the country to do just that, because it's really the heavy lifting in the Santa world. But we believe every child deserves the opportunity to visit with Santa Claus.
Tell us the little history of how this started in 2003.
Well, Santa Ernest Berger, previous to that time, back in 1999, was living in Atlanta, Georgia with his wife. And his wife was very ill with pancreatic cancer. And spent her last days at hospice house in Atlanta. And after, while they were there, there was a family that had a young baby who had an inoperable brain tumor.
Oh, no.
And they were unable to care for her at home. So the family had her at hospice house. And during the night and other times when family wasn't able to be there, all of the patients and their families took turns holding and rocking this little girl.
Mm.
And she passed within a few days of Ernie's wife. He was kind of at a loss as to what to do, moved from Atlanta, retired, moved to Daphne, and he tells the story that he woke up one morning, put his feet on the floor, and said to no one in particular, "I know. I'll grow my beard and be a hospice Santa." And then he kind of looked around the room and said, "Who said that?" He said, "Where did that come from?" And that's what he did. And he started it down there and started recruiting other like-minded individuals. And that's how Santa America got developed.
I love that story. You know, from someone's pain and loss, they found something joyful that they could do to help others. 2003, this starts. How did it grow? I mean, how did he make it viral? Yes, the internet was out there, but how did it spread?
For a bunch of old gray-haired fat guys, it was the beginning stages of the internet for us. And we started communicating that way. I got involved because there was a request for Santas to come in 2005 to the Gulf Coast and visit children that had suffered through Hurricane Katrina. And while we never really pulled off an event, it raised our awareness of the things that really needed to be done. And that's how I got started. And I've been an active volunteer ever since, until now I'm the volunteer president.
Let's talk about, how do you train a Santa? because you do have training. I don't want people to think you just come in with this long white beard and, hey, you're in.
Well, in some respects, it's a little bit like herding cats. But we just had our symposium here, our first ever, where we had our own standalone training event. We have done training in other venues as part of other programs. But this was our first standalone in September. We held it at the Overland Park or the Johnson County Arts and Heritage Center, which is a fabulous facility. And we trained Santas on death, grief, and bereavement with a nationally known PhD speaker to talk about how to handle Santa things. You know, how do you handle it when a child looks you in the eye when, you know, Santa asks the question that we ask everyone, and that is, of course, and what would you like for Christmas? And to have a six-year-old look you in the eye and say, I don't want to die. And how do you handle that? How do you handle it in the moment? How do you handle it after you leave? So that's what we spent hours talking about that. We also did, we had a nationally known PhD level speaker on autism to talk about how communication with children on the autism spectrum is and what we can do to facilitate those visits. And then we did post-traumatic stress in two parts. One, post-traumatic stress for children. And the other, and we do work with the military, visiting wounded warriors and their family. And as we do that, how do you go through that process with soldiers that have seen the worst of the worst and given them all for our country? And how do we help support them?
What are some of the tips that they shared, these experts shared with you all, so that you are sensitive and aware?
Well, the thing that kind of crossed the boundary of all of those is to be empathetic. You have to learn everything you can learn about the situation before you get there. When you knock on the door, forget it all and be in the moment. It's crucial to be in the moment. You have to visit a child where they are, physically, emotionally, spiritually. If it means getting on the floor, you do that. If it means climbing into the hospital bed, you do that. If they may be playing just fine, even though they've got a terminal illness, and you have to be ready to do that. Some days are up, some days are down. So you have to be in that moment. Be sensitive to what the child, how guides the experience. You also have to, like I said, be prepared to decompress because these are difficult visits.
I would imagine.
Emotionally.
How does Santa handle it after a bombshell question of, you know?
And we've got
I don't
a network.
Die.
We've got a network of Santas, and we talk to each other. My wife is the best, but she has not made these visits and had that experience. Sometimes I need to talk to a Santa that's had that experience.
Right.
So we've got a network to do that. We've got six or seven of us volunteers here in the Kansas City area and pushing 100 nationally. Because, again, this is difficult emotional work. Not everybody's cut out for it. When we did our first training session in 2006, that was a big event, I asked the question at the front of the room. I said, how many of you make hospice visits? There were a few hands. I said, how many would you like to make hospice visits? There were a lot more hands. And then I said, then why don't you? And we went around the room and answered that question. And the three top answers were, I'm afraid I'll say the wrong thing. I'm afraid I won't know what to say. And I'm afraid I'll break down emotionally while I'm on the visit.
And by this training, it really helps your volunteer Santas and elves.
Yep.
Because I understand it's not just Santas.
That's right. Santa, Mrs. Claus, and elves. The other piece of this is we have a leave behind that's called a hug. A hug is a scarf with mittens on the end of it. And we put the scarf around a child's neck. We ask their permission, put the scarf around their neck, ask them to put their hands in the mitten, and when they put their hands in the mitten, to give themselves a squeeze. And at the same time, with permission, Santa gives the child a hug and says to them, when you're having a bad day, put the hug on, give yourself a squeeze, and know that it's a hug coming from Santa, because Santa is there for you all the time. And I have been to more wakes or funerals than I can count where the hug has been there.
Oh, my gosh. Who makes the hugs? Santa and the elves. But
we are.
How do they really get made?
How do they really get made? We have volunteer elves that we're always looking for more. So if someone is interested in following our pattern, because we're very specific that these need to be the way they need to be made. But if somebody's looking to volunteer to make some for us, we would love to have you help us out.
So how do they get in touch with you if they want to be the bonus elves?
The easiest way is to go to the website, which is www.santaamerica.org. And there is a place that you can click to volunteer and fill out the form and send it in. And Elf Helen and I will receive your inquiry, and we will get in touch and we'll start working through the process.
So how do you plan your visits? How do organizations or people connect with you? And you don't go out and just do, you know, like someone's neighborhood party.
Yeah, as individuals, yes, we do.
Oh, you do that as
well.
We
do other things. Personally, I do lots of visits of varying kinds, but about half of what I do in a season is volunteer work. As an example, I personally am a volunteer for Kansas City Hospice and Palliative Care. So I get, you know, we're already starting to talk about children that are in their care that families would like to have a visit from Santa. And we make the arrangement and Santa goes to the house or wherever the child may be to pay a visit. And it's great because I have one little girl that I visited 13 years ago as a hospice patient. The medical prognosis was not good. She was not expected to survive. And I visited her last year for year number 13.
Oh, that's a cool story. That's got to warm your heart. How do you do this? What's it like when you go out for a visit in a hospital or a military setting? You've been doing it a little while.
Yes, this is year 45 for me.
Oh, my gosh. But not with Santa America.
That came later.
How do you handle that, those tough situations?
Again, the main thing is you have to be in the moment. And as long as you stay in the moment and not think about what happened before I got here, what's going to happen after I leave, those are things that'll have to wait till another time.
Not your shopping list.
No. They'll wait till I'm done, till I'm on the porch or in the car. Hopefully I can get to the car, but it doesn't always happen. Sometimes I get to the front door and the waterworks start. But, you know, you just go do it because children deserve everything we can give them.
So if folks here in Kansas City wanted to get in touch and have a Santa America visit, they go through your website?
Go to the website.
And are these visits free? Does someone make a donation to you? I mean, you got to somehow perpetuate.
We would always appreciate a donation, but Santa America visits for children in our center of our focus. Those are no charge.
And just in the holiday season?
No, we'll visit 365 days a year.
I knew Christmas was a 365 day a year type of thing.
It sure is.
And do you ever get called out to visit a child or an adult who's maybe not used to Santa, maybe through their faith tradition? So
yes.
How do you handle that?
You just go. I mean, and you have conversation. You start slow and you start easy. If we have a child that has sensory issues, for instance, somewhere on the autism spectrum, we may take off the hat, take off the glasses, take off the belt, to even take off the boots sometimes, to be as soft-edged and casual as can be, because that helps the child communicate better. We're also asked questions in advance to make sure what triggers they might have. So we're making sure that we're in the child's, again, back to what I said before, that we visit the child where they are.
So you do take volunteers, and if folks want to connect with you then to have Santa come out, how do you all sustain what you do?
We're funded by a number of organizations, but it's all donations. Again, we're a 501c3. We don't have any big grants. It doesn't take a lot to operate, but we do have to, you know, sustain ourselves financially. And part of it is buying the materials to make hugs.
Right.
The demand for hugs is great. Our ability to supply nationally is, we're up and down sometimes with that. So the more we have in our warehouse, the better off we are.
And I assume you could use some more Santas and Mrs. Clauses. So if you're rocking that look, you want to go to santaamerica.org and just get in contact with you all. You all, I'm sure, can join arms together and have a few more of you out there to do all this wonderful work that you do.
There's one other thing that we do, that we've created a program we call Subs for Santa. Subs for Santa stands for Socks, Underwear, and Belts. We collect new children's socks, underwears, and belts wherever we have a Santa America volunteer who chooses to do a program. And the great thing about it is whatever gets collected locally stays local. We're not shipping stuff all over the country. So everything that gets collected in Kansas City, for example, stays here in Kansas City. Last year, we distributed almost 6,000 items.
Oh, that's tremendous. Well, Santa John, thank you so much for what you're doing and for Santa America, and the fact that it's based here is so wonderful. And we hope listeners will reach out and support what you're doing, volunteer. It's a great effort, 365 days a year.
Thank you very much. And remember, keep being good. Santa is watching. Ho, ho, ho!
Inspired by Ewan Marion Kaufman, the Kaufman Foundation believes that every person, regardless of their background, can take risks, achieve success, and give back to their communities. We work together with our Kansas City community and beyond through investments in education and entrepreneurship that create uncommon solutions. By listening first to the communities we serve, we seek to understand the problems and dream big with people to build innovative programs that deliver results. Learn more at Kaufman.org.
Unexpected reactions to smart financial decisions brought to you by FeedThePig.org.
Well, I finally did it. I opened a 401k.
So you're giving up, just like that?
Giving up on what?
On getting an inheritance from a distant relative.
Don't you think if there were a billionaire in the family, we'd know about it by now?
Listen to me, we are one phone call away from riding horses on our own private polo grounds. One call from christening yachts, having a butler, using summer as a verb.
How do you figure?
Look, everyone's got a rich uncle somewhere. It's statistics. So the best thing you can do is just prepare for the inevitable.
Right, which is why I thought maybe it would be smart to take control of my finances. You know, start using a budget, get out of debt, set some retirement goals.
Budgets? Debt? You watch your mouth. Retirement shouldn't be a goal for us. It should be a way of life.
When it comes to financial stability, don't get left behind. Get tools and tips for saving at feedthepig.org. This message brought to you by the American Institute of CPAs and the Ad Council.
You're not wired to have a response to this sound. You're neutral to it. You hear it every time you finish a meal and never feel anything. But if we were able to associate this sound with a new stimulus, save the food. We've achieved pulling a natural response from you. Save the food. Why are we doing this, you may ask? Save the food. Because this ad is trying to change your after-meal behavior through brainwashing. Because food waste costs the average family $1,500 a year. Save the food. Cha-ching. And $1,500 extra is like getting a pay raise. Save the food. Cha-ching.
You're promoted.
Which could pay for your child's braces. Save the food. Cha-ching.
You're promoted.
Check out my braces.
So when you hear this sound, rethink your behavior. Cook it store it, share it. Just don't waste it. For tips and recipes, visit SaveTheFood.com. Brought to you by NRDC and the Ad Council.
You wanted to see me?
Yes, please, have a seat. So here's the thing. When this company brought you on, we took a chance on you. You didn't have that 4-year college degree we typically look for.
Right.
But we gave you a shot anyway. And since then, you've worked incredibly hard and given it your all.
Thanks.
You've been an important asset to the team, but I don't think you can be an intern here anymore. We want to hire you.
You're serious?
Absolutely.
Find your next great employee. Introduce yourself to the grads of life. Who are they? Talent worth knowing about. Young adults of unique determination and experience. An ideal fit for your company in an entry-level position, internship, or even mentorship. They might not have every qualification you typically look for, but they're exactly who your company needs.
I won't let you down.
I know.
Don't miss out on a resource many innovative companies have already discovered. Go to gradsoflife.org to learn how to find, cultivate, and train this great pool of untapped talent. Brought to you by the Ad Council and gradsoflife.org.
What my eyes have seen. Sending Michael off to kindergarten. His first home run. Graduation day. Mike and Lisa just had a baby. But I'll never see my granddaughter's face. I have macular degeneration, a disease that threatens the sight of more than 9 million Americans. Call 1-800-437-2423 for a free booklet on symptoms, treatment, and resources from Macular Degeneration Research. That's 1-800-437-2423.
Welcome back to KC Cares, Kansas City's nonprofit voice and digital resource. We're helping organizations survive and thrive, and we're going to tell your story to our community. I'm Ruth Baum-Biggis. Bobby is away today. We have a grassroots organization here out in the Johnson County area that I know is just going to catch on fire and grow exponentially. And it's a group called Fathers Club. I was introduced to it by former Kansas City Chief Sean Barber, committed dad of six, had coffee and was talking with some of the gentlemen from this group, and it just sounded like such an interesting and heartfelt endeavor. And we have with us today the Chief Executive Officer, Brad Holdhusen. Welcome, Brad.
Thank you.
And we have Vince Stevens, who's the president. Mm. We have all the top echelon here. Wow.
Just for you, Ruth.
Oh, thank you. Well, thank you both for giving time to come in and talk about Fathers Club. What is this? You obviously have to be a father, I would think, to be part of the Fathers Club. Tell us what this is. What's your focus?
Brad, why don't you?
Yeah, so we this is definitely a tandem story, something I attempted about 4.5 years ago, but unsuccessful. Somewhat similar, a little bit of cross pattern or cross pollination, and then Vince came up and had something brewing in his mind. About a year, a little over, almost a year and a half ago, grabbed my arm at a Blue Valley High School football auction and said, hey, I wanted to talk to you about something. And maybe 30, 60 seconds into him describing, it immediately pulled the heartstrings out of me on what I would had tried 3.5 years prior to that. And today that has become what we call the Fathers Club. And that brief meeting at that auction ended up being a couple breakfast meetings where we flushed a couple things out and then cast a net to about 7 or 8 guys, 6 of which showed up with Vince and I on my back patio one night. And what we thought was going to be about an hour-long meeting ended up being 4 hours, and that was kind of our main springboard. So what would you add
sure.
to that?
Well, let me just add that it began with an understanding that there were issues with kids, and because of those issues, families were being fractured and there were trouble in homes. And so as Brad and I recognized that that was true, the question became, what can we do about it? And so we were understanding that the Blue Valley High School principal, Scott Bacon, was already dealing with these issues, but he was already trying to love kids in a great way. And so our question was how can we be difference makers and maybe come alongside Scott and make a difference? And so when we met Scott, we heard some things that were startling. in terms of not only were there the drinking issues that we were aware of and some of the other issues, but there were kids who were being negatively impacted by social media. There were opioid addicts that exist at Blue Valley, and that kids were dying. And the other thing Scott said was moms were doing a great job showing up with consistency. Dads were parachuting in, leaving things at the door and leaving. And so if we could get dads involved with consistency and dads who are committed to love kids and to be available for kids and to listen to kids and to keep coming back, that ultimately that would make a difference. And so, as Brad said, we started to reach out to folks who we knew were committed dads and started meeting and just started showing up, and it's making a difference.
What was there a catalyst that started you, Brad, into this? You said 4 years ago you had kind of tried to do something engaging dads or males in a family situation. Mm-hmm. I mean, it could be a guardian, I assume.
Yeah, oh, for sure. So actually what I attempted 4.5 years ago was nothing like what we had today. And what has become clear is almost like sharing a brain, what was on my heart and what I attempted, and we did two events around it back in 2015, I believe it was, fall, spring of 2015, was more for a parents' hub. Fast forward to kind of, again, thoughts and ideas Vince brought about what was on his heart, but he nailed it. You know, what really kind of seeded this, we had ideas, and we literally said the words to each other on my back deck, and then getting together with Principal Bacon and a couple other, our football player and our athletic director, was, we don't know what this is going to be. So the seeding, to answer your question, the seeding part in both of our hearts separately was to have some type of intentional, impactful way to pull parents together, and that quickly morphed into dads. Partially based on the combination of Mr. Bacon's comments to us and our realization that moms have done phenomenal. You know, this is not to take away from their skills and how they have kicked our tails for years in this area. quite contrary, this is for us to finally, in a very meaningful way, complement what they've already been doing. So with Mr. Bacon saying that, the thing that came up in this now is part of our logo today. Is I remember telling him, we want you to feel like we are, as dads, locking arms around you, this administration, this school, these kids, literally and figuratively. So that's kind of, it's a conglomeration of a few things that really got us here. But the specific piece on dads coming together kind of evolved with the two of us and Mr. Bacon's comments and desires.
And this was all percolated up at Blue Valley High School.
Yes, ma'am. Yep.
Does the organization like have regular meetings? Do you plan programs? I mean, tell us what you do.
Mm-hmm. So the locking arms, I'm going to give a little tee up and then I'll pass you the baton here.
Sure.
The locking arms piece, we thought of what one thing dads do is sometimes we make things maybe even too simple. So we kept with that thread. We knew when we were in high school, one thing that was very important to us is food. So we decided, okay, we're going to bring chicken biscuits to the school as a kind of a splash event. And we're going to surround the school literally and cover every entrance and give chicken biscuits to all the kids as they're coming in the morning for a little breakfast pop. And also very specifically to try to get those eyes off the phones walking in and get them up looking at us with a grin, try to get them to smile, give them a fist bump, a high five, a bear hug to our kids, you know, and their friends, some of them that wanted it. And just to sprinkle a different feeling as these kids entered the school. And then finish that thought.
So in addition to those engagements, we discovered something along the way. Ultimately, one of the things that dads struggle with is just being open and honest about our own issues. And as we would gather for events for the kids, we started to talk to each other. And something incredible happened. And it's happening here with Brad and I as we got to know each other. And, you know, Brad is one of my best friends today. And I didn't know him before that great meeting where we were talking about those things that we saw among kids that we were concerned about. And so in a lot of cases, dads are starting to meet and talk, and we are discovering that we have the same issues in our home. So in addition to going into the schools and making a difference, we're talking about how to be better husbands and fathers among each other and really being honest about the struggles that we have. You know, one of the struggles I talk about was with my own son. I discovered that day with Scott Bacon that I wasn't engaging with my son the way I should have. I wasn't looking at his phone. And ultimately, we started to develop that relationship, that accountability. And we hear those kind of stories among dads. So
this is kind of a bonus. It sounds like your intent was really to embrace the kids, mm-hmm. and now it sounds like it's created a platform for men to embrace men yeah. in friendship and yes. camaraderie outside of the workplace.
You nailed it. Yep. I heard a dad recently. It was actually another great organization, Town F3, and Bill Green, who runs that, said, he goes, you know, as men outside of the workplace, we've got, just to be really blunt, and this is how he explained it, I'm going to use his words, and he was spot on. Guys have friendships that are either, you know, bar stool, drinking beer, watching sports, which is fun, great, and some maybe some other dark, tough things, whether it's strip clubs and, you know, very surfacey, selfish relationships. But it's very uncommon where you have men cracking their chest and saying, you know what, my wife and I, we went head-to-head last night over this issue, or, man, I'm battling with my kids over this issue. And you know what? One of my kids is dealing with anxiety big time. And all of a sudden, when you start to dive into some transparency, transparency breeds more transparency. And that allows for a community to come knit together. And specifically, when you have dads cracking their chest and having those conversations, we've had dads say some amazing things about how they're a better father, a better husband, and they're just more tuned in to what's going on in the house, not because anything, we're a couple of knuckleheads. So no, is all the guys that
I
run this thing.
I wouldn't say that.
You know, we are just simply, and we say this all the time, we are simply dads. We don't have counseling degrees. We don't have things figured out. And kind of the beauty in that transparency and rawness is what draws us all together. Okay, you guys don't have it figured out either. Man, I'm coming to that. Let's go have a happy hour and talk about something a little bit more in depth about helping our kids, our dads, and then other community-related efforts. Those are our three lanes that we focus on.
So it's a relational type of organization, I guess, if I can make up a word.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What other things then have you done at school? Do you schedule when you go and do stuff around the kids? You say it's intentional, so I'm wondering, you know, how often and what that means.
You want to talk about the mental health thing that with the kids, or did you have another thought?
I had another thought.
Okay, take it.
Well, yeah. We can do both. How's yeah. that? Well, the five minutes we have left.
You know, one of the primary themes among the guys is the choice to love. You know, dads who choose to love make a difference. And so what we're discovering is when we show up at schools and we just become available to others without any expectation in return, it makes a difference even in our lives. And so what that transfers to is great conversations among dads who are discovering this love dynamic and this opportunity to give of themselves in a great way. And not only in the schools that we are committed to, but in our own homes.
Where else are you besides Blue Valley? Because you've grown this a bit.
We're in the Blue Valley District right now in the five schools.
In the five high schools.
The Blue Valley District, although there are other schools that we are preparing to onboard, if you will. But we're preparing for whatever's out there, because mm-hmm. when folks are hearing about this love dynamic and the fact that it's making a difference, you know, it's attractive, and it's making a difference.
How do you see it making a difference? I mean, are kids telling you this, or are yeah. teachers, you know, who's telling you it's working?
Yeah, so great question. We had our Blue Valley superintendent, Dr. Todd White, reach out when we posted something on social media about our mental health first aid training we did last year. So one very tactical, kind of where the rubber meets the road example, we had a gentleman who sits on our board, Tom Herzog, stand up in our first, what we call our weight room meetings, when a bunch of dads get together. And we were talking about mental health issues and how, as dads, we want to figure out a way we can do something. Dads, we like to do things, right?
Right.
And solve problems. Tom stands up, says, I'd love to host, make an offer to host a first mental health first aid training. So fast forward to, I think it was early March last year, we did that. Had 26 dads come and spend a Saturday getting mental health first aid trained. That spawned other things that eventually went into the other four other Blue Valley high schools. And then this year, we have decided to team up with Johnson County Mental Health, and Tim DeWee is the director over there. And we're going to do a partnership with a goal to train 100 dads by the end of the school year. So we're going to have dates off the top of my head here. I know November 23rd is going to be the first one, and we're getting ready to release those registration links, which will fill up pretty quickly. But they're all capped. All three of these dates are capped at 35 dads. January, there's one in after the first year, January and March are the other ones. But that's a very practical, tactical way that we've tried to attack some of these.
And they
things.
Can find all of that on fathersclub.org?
Yes, there's fathersclub.org. Our events tab is going to have more information about those mental health first aid training events.
Do you have to have a kid in the districts?
I mean, you don't have to.
If you've had a kid go through, I mean, is this just for dads who've got current kids, or is this trying to build even a larger community?
I think that's the hope that we have, is that ultimately the entire community will have a great impact. And there are dads who are part of our group right now who do not have kids in the high schools or in the schools. And ultimately, we may not, but we want to continue to be available for other kids and other dads and other families, and ultimately make a difference in their lives. So,
well, I salute you for stepping up and saying, hey, we're going to be present and we're going to be engaged and involved. I hear from other gentlemen from time to time that they feel kind of lost. The women's movement came, it's established, sure. All of that. And so, okay, how do the guys adjust? Mm-hmm. How do we find our lane that's compatible mm-hmm. and not necessarily competitive? And it mm-hmm. sounds like you've mm-hmm. developed something that addresses both those things.
Yeah. Not only not competitive and compatible, but complementary. You know, our goal and desire is for our wives' shoulders to relax. And, you know, for those of us that are married, whether we have kids in the district or not, and say, gosh, you know, I see and experience a difference in my husband. So that's a big deal for what we're trying to accomplish. But no, they don't have to have a kid in the district. They could be a grandpa. They could have kids that have graduated. The more the merrier.
And again, it's fathersclub.org. Vince and Brad, thanks so much. Salute to the dads that are engaged. And if you all are interested, please go to their website. They've got great information there. And who knows, you might show up at a school and get a free chicken biscuit when you walk in the door. Thanks again.
Thank you.
Inspired by Ewan Marion Kaufman, the Kaufman Foundation believes that every person, regardless of their background, can take risks, achieve success, and give back to their communities. We work together with our Kansas City community and beyond through investments in education and entrepreneurship that create uncommon solutions. By listening first to the communities we serve, we seek to understand the problems and dream big with people to build innovative programs that deliver results. Learn more at Kaufman.org.
Driving means
freedom,
exploration,
fun,
pride,
flexibility,
travel, protection,
ability,
friendship,
escape,
control. Independence.
Distracted driving means
danger,
recklessness,
irresponsible,
chaos,
police,
devastation,
injury,
tears,
death.
Safe driving means staying alert and staying alive.
Visit StopTextStopWrecks.org, a message brought to you by the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, Project Yellow Light, Noise, and the Ad Council.
I'm Howie Mandel. Did you know attention deficit hyperactivity disorder in adults is a real and treatable medical disorder? I know because I am one of the estimated 10 million adults in the U.S. who have ADHD. The symptoms of ADHD, inattention, hyperactivity, and impulsivity make it difficult to pay attention and focus, be organized, complete tasks, and maintain relationships. I've been diagnosed with ADHD. In my life, I've often misplaced things and have found it difficult to sit down and read a script for work or even have a conversation. You know, the kind when you're actually listening without interrupting. It's never too late for adults to seek help for ADHD and find the right treatment plan. Get information at adultadhdisreal.com and take an ADHD self-screener. Talk to your doctor. The right treatment plan can help control your symptoms so you can stay focused and organized, get things done at home and work, and help improve relationships. Visit adultadhdisreal.com to learn more about adult ADHD. Don't let ADHD prevent you from achieving your goals. I haven't.
Peter Herrick was a 34-year-old carpenter when he joined the Navy Reserve. Peter's wife, Diana.
They were deployed to build schools and bases and to assist the Marines.
When the mortar round hit, I was completely knocked out. I didn't wake up until 6 days later.
Paralyzed veteran, senior National Service Officer Raymond Bruce.
I saw Pete when he was at his worst. He didn't know if he was going to live to be able to see his daughter graduate from high school.
Raymond knew that I needed help figuring out where do we go from here.
We not only represent the veteran, but we represent the whole family.
11 months we stayed in the hospital down in Tampa.
We advocate, we educate, and we process claims through the VA, and we follow that claim from the beginning to the end.
Without Paralyzed Veterans of America, I really honestly believe I'd still be in the hospital.
You can help our paralyzed veterans. To learn more, visit pva.org, a public service of Paralyzed Veterans of America.
Hey, America, we're your pets, and this song's dedicated to those people who don't have health insurance yet.
In Roe, we say.
There's a plan for every budget, so don't accept defeat. Now you can get covered and still
buy me treats.
Enroll!
So listen to me, a talking pug, you see. If you get health insurance, preventive care is now free.
So sweet.
You take care of your pets. Now it's their turn to take care of you. Visit GetCoveredAmerica.org to learn about your health insurance options. That's GetCoveredAmerica.org. Brought to you by Get Covered America and the Ad Council.
Welcome back to KC Cares, Kansas City's window on the nonprofit community and the people they serve. I'm Ruth Baum-Biggis. We're going to talk with a lady who is a powerhouse here in Kansas City, has a passion for what she does, and makes things happen. We have Sharon Payne, founder of Bra Couture.
Hi.
Sharon, I'm so glad that you could come on the show. I know you've
Thank
been
you.
Dealing with all kinds of fun health things, and you look pretty doggone good.
Well,
so whatever you're doing, keep it up.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bra Couture. We're talking undergarments, but in a very different way.
Yes. As a matter of fact, we really like to stress that Bra Couture is not about the bra. That it really is about that 100-foot runway that breast cancer survivors walk to celebrate their survivorship. And they do that so that we can raise money for uninsured and underinsured cancer patients here in Kansas City. And next year we celebrate our 10th year anniversary, and we have raised over $2 million. So hopefully next year it'll be closer to $2.5 million by the time we get through. Yes.
That is amazing.
Yes.
And with a runway
very
show.
Proud.
Take us back, though. This had its infancy a little, well, as you say, 10 years
mm-hmm.
before.
Mm-hmm.
How did you come up with this?
Well, the idea actually came from my daughter-in-law, my then-daughter-in-law, who was a young cancer survivor. She was diagnosed when she was 32 years old. She lives in Austin, Texas. And there wasn't a breast cancer resource center in Austin or a Young Survivor Coalition. And so when she got through her journey, she decided she wanted to have a breast cancer resource center there. And a bunch of young survivors got together, and they had seen the idea of taking a bra and turning it into a piece of art, and then using that, either selling it or using that as a means in which to raise not only awareness of breast cancer itself, but as a way to raise funds. And so they threw out the idea to all the artists in Austin, and the bras came in, and they were extraordinary, and they said, hey, we can wear these on the runway. And so 2 years later, I was diagnosed with breast cancer and survived that. All of my physicians and relationships are with the University of Kansas. And so I wanted to bring this to Kansas City. I've been involved in the community in Kansas City for years, and I knew I wanted to bring this idea to Kansas City, so I presented it to KU, and KU came back and said, we want to do this, we want to partner with you to do this, and we want you to raise money to support a Patients in Need Fund at Missy's Boutique that would focus on providing services for uninsured cancer patients. And so I was like, you know, committed through and through from the very first moment I heard that, because myself and now all of the volunteers, this is a volunteer-driven organization, many of whom are breast cancer survivors, could not imagine facing this disease without insurance. And so initially it started out that we were providing wigs and prosthetics, and then we found out about lymphedema garments, and that lymphedema is not covered by insurance. So, you know, I went to KU and said, I would like to provide lymphedema garments inside of Missy's Boutique as well. And Dr. Sui said, we don't have a lymphedema services practice here. So they hired Dr. Jamie Wagner from MD Anderson, and she heads up the lymphedema services practice at KU now. And it's one of the leading lymphedema services practices in the United States of America. So, but very quickly, we had raised over $300,000. So,
wow.
Yeah, and so I was trying initially to go into the community and into the underserved communities and really make women there aware of this fund that was at KU and try to encourage them to come to KU for those services. And that's when I, you know, really bumped into what poverty in Kansas City is like and the inability for them to get to KU. So we decided, rather than trying to bring those women to KU, that we would take the money to them. So now we have what we're calling a cancer services center, because we've expanded the kinds of services we provide in these centers. We have one at Truman Medical Center. We have one called Virtus Place at the Sarah Cannon Cancer Center at Research Hospital. We're opening one in 2020, early 2020, at North Kansas City Hospital. And I just initiated a relationship with Samuel U. Rogers Medical Center.
Oh,
so we're
great.
Talking to them, and you know how fabulous that facility is. So, and then we, Imaging for Women, donated 200 free mammograms to us. And so we, every quarter, we take a party bus into the underserved communities, and we pick up 50 women, and we bring them for their annual mammogram screenings, or sometimes mammogram screenings for the very first time.
And this all started with your relationship with your daughter-in-law.
Exactly.
And then
exactly.
You ended up on a similar journey.
Yes, exactly. I did.
How does your organization work? Are you all volunteer? I mean, it's a big undertaking.
It is a big undertaking, and we have an annual event. That event is going to be on April the 24th, 2020. We have this event at Signature Hangar at the downtown airport, and we sell out at 1,200 to 1,300 people. So we take an empty airplane hangar, private jets that are those multi-million dollar beautiful jets. They move all of those out of that hangar, and we sweep in there. And by the time we get through, it looks like a ballroom, and it's all done with volunteers. And so, you know, it's a big undertaking, and it kind of wears us out for about 3 to 4 months.
I would bet.
Yeah.
In going out into the community.
Yes.
What do you see with these funds that you raise from this fabulous fashion show? And I would encourage everyone to go to your website because there are some pictures there. And we'll post some as well. It's at bracouturekc.com.
Correct.
What's it like when you can, when you pick up some of these women, for example, to go take them to their mammogram?
Okay. I would love to share that with you because, you know, we have some really harsh demographics that are here in Kansas City. And one is that one of the highest percentages of women losing their lives to breast cancer in America is within the community of women of color in Wyandotte County. And you know that there's limited to no medical services there for women. The second demographic is that over 70% of the women who present as uninsured cancer patients to Truman Medical Center are already at stage 4.
Oh, my gosh.
And we know that 52% of the women in Kansas City who have insurance don't get their annual mammograms. And we know that 1 in 8 women are going to be diagnosed with breast cancer. So the other demographic that, and this is the one that I want to share with you, the other demographic that is at risk is all of the rural communities that sit all the way around Kansas City. You know, those small medical centers are being closed, and so those women don't have any anywhere to get screened as well. So last year we decided that for one of our annual mammogram screening events, we would reach into the rural community in the Northland. And so we were able, through some amazing Northland health agencies, helped us promote this event. We were able to bring in 52 women to be screened. And when you're there at the imaging center and they come in, they're real quiet and they go in for their screening and they come out and they're in tears and they're calling people on the phone saying, I'm okay. I was so scared. I'd never been screened. I was just so worried, or, you know, I haven't had a mammogram for 7 or 8 years. So to see that is really, really wonderful to know that you can bring some peace of mind to women. Now, if we do find an abnormality, we have created a relationship with Truman Medical Center and North Kansas City Hospital to fast-track those women for immediate care if they are diagnosed with any kind of an abnormality. So we don't leave anybody hanging. We know that if you come here and we discover something, we're going to make sure we follow through the whole entire process with you to be sure you're okay and that you survive.
You go out and you find these women.
Yes.
Do women also come to you? Do they contact you through the website or anything like that?
Occasionally they do. I really am looking for, particularly in Wyandotte County, I'm really looking for organizations in Wyandotte County to reach out to us because I would like to do two of our screening events in Wyandotte County. So that's like we could bring in over 100 women on an annualized basis. And we can even take more if we need to. That's the one area that I've had just a little bit of difficulty integrating into and increasing the awareness in that area that we're offering this. And so we're going to reach out to the Wyandotte County Health Association, and there's a couple of other resources. But that is one area where we really are continuing to seek partnerships with organizations that would help us find the women so that we can screen them.
I'm amazed that here you were dealing with what can be a life-threatening illness. And, I mean, you put your boots to the ground and you said, let's go. Talk about a little of that journey.
Well, I really have to say that so much of it had to do with the fact that when KU said to me, we're going to raise money for women who don't have insurance, it's shocking to think about how you would manage your cancer without insurance. As an example, you're not going to get reconstructive surgery, although I think there is some, they're working on getting more and more programs of ways that you can get reconstructive surgery. But for the most part, you don't. You don't get your wig. You don't get a prosthetic. You don't get those, what I would say, appearance items that are really, really important to women. And then what we have started doing is we will sustain a family for up to 3 months if, because frequently in the underserved communities, the kinds of jobs that those individuals have, they don't get paid if they don't work. So if they're not working while they're in treatment, how are they going to sustain themselves? So we pay their utilities. We give them food cards. We give them gas cards.
Oh, my goodness.
Just to make sure that they can get through that really, really tough area. But what has happened, and I think this is almost the most important thing to say about Brocator, is that, yes, I started this and we kind of kicked it off and you know, we launched it in partnership with KU, which was phenomenal, and Janice Benjamin and Jeff Wright and Bob Page, you know, those early years, of course, KU helped us promote it and get it out there. But every year that we've had this event, the women who are on the runway as models then become involved with the organization as volunteers. And it's really that power from the volunteers that has helped this grow. And then beyond that, it's really continually being aware of what the needs are in the city. In knowing that, okay, well, Truman is a safety net hospital, so we definitely have to be there. Or Sarah Cannon is by Swope Park, and that's an underserved community, and we need to be there. We need to be providing services there. So we work through the Research Foundation to open Verda's Place, which is in honor of Verda Salberg, who was a first-year model who lost her life to breast cancer. And then you find out that, okay, well, there's a lot of uninsured people in the north, in the north area of Kansas City, and so we need to be there. So to a certain extent, we've grown because we've been pulled in the direction of where the needs are and how can we continue to serve those needs and what are the additional kinds of things that we can provide. So another example of that is with the University of Kansas, because they have cancer centers that are located in the suburban areas of greater Kansas City. The lymphedema services, they have these very highly sophisticated lymphedema measuring machines that we purchased for them that they are now putting in those cancer centers that are out in the communities. So that helps individuals who don't have insurance to be able to get there and have those services. So it's something that the whole entire Brocator organization is extremely, extremely passionate about, because we see these women, we touch these women, we get to see the results of what we're doing for them, and that it makes such a huge difference in their lives.
Well, it's fabulous what you're doing with all your dedicated volunteers.
Thank you.
Brocatourkc.org. And be sure and watch for the April 24th, 2020 information. You got to line up early.
Yes.
It's a popular event. And kudos, because all that money goes to really wonderful things right here.
Yes.
In Kansas City.
Yes.
And it shows you care. Thank you, Sharon.
Thank you.
And we want to thank you for listening to KC Cares, Kansas City's nonprofit digital resource. We're produced by Charitable Communications, a 501c3 nonprofit organization. KC Cares is generously underwritten by the Mewing Marion Kauffman Foundation. KC Cares podcasts are available at kccaresonline.org. If you'd like to be a guest or for underwriting opportunities, please visit kccaresonline.org. Spread the love. And you can find us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter at KC Cares Online. We want to thank you for listening to KC Cares on ESPN 1510 AM and 94.5 FM.
Yeah. ESPN Kansas City is KCTE Independence and K233 DM Raytown, 1510 AM, 94.5 FM.